you've heard about it. Okay, good number. Good. So, I mean, probably most of you would know, but yeah, Meteor is like a new framework. It's pretty new. It's 0.06, not even 1.0 yet. So, where Meteor shines is that, you know, it makes it really easy for you to create multi-user real-time applications. So it abstracts away the configurational details. So you're just left with a tool set that you need to like rapidly prototype applications. I mean, you don't need to set up anything. You don't need to set up your server. You don't need to, you know, call in. You don't need to figure out your dependencies. You don't need to call in script tags. You don't need to import your CSS files. Just put it where Meteor wants you to put it, and then, you know, just write your business logic as you would. So what is Meteor? It's built on Node.js. We just talked about Node.js, so it's built on Node.js. So it's JavaScript everywhere. On the client, you write your, apart from HTML and CSS, you write everything in JavaScript. And on the server, anything that you write is put inside a Node.js container. So on the server, it runs Node.js. And Meteor just sits in between your database and your UI, and just has the job of keeping both of them in sync at all times. The data that's in your database and the data that's shown to your users on the UI is kept in sync by Meteor. So like I said, it's a single language. Use JavaScript on the server, you use JavaScript on the client, it's JavaScript everywhere. It really shines when you're creating real-time applications. We'll just see an example, but I think you'll really like the way it handles conflict resolution and asynchronous updates. So installing Meteor is pretty easy. So just run this one command from your terminal. It should be pretty easy. It just curls a bunch of files from meteor.com into your /bin/sh. So this command only works on Linux, and so if it's pretty small, I'll just bump up the font size. It just downloads a bunch of file into your /bin/sh. But if you're on Windows, this won't work. So for Windows, go to win.meteor.com and download the executable that's given here. So Windows is not supported, natively by Meteor, but some guys, because Meteor is open source, some guys have worked on a Windows solution for this. So just download this this exe and just run it. Are you downloading it? I mean, is it running?
Yes.
Okay. So everyone started downloading it, right? Exactly. Okay. So we'll come to creating your app later. You know, when everyone has Meteor running, we'll come to creating your app then. But right now, we'll talk about some principles that Meteor is built on top of. So essentially, so there are seven principles. One is data on the wire. This essentially means that the server only sends you data, not HTML. It's the client's responsibility to use that data and render some HTML. Then the next one is single language. It uses JavaScript everywhere, on the client, on the server, everywhere it's JavaScript. And the thing I'd like to note here is that you're free to use Angular or Backbone or jQuery, anything on the client. And similarly, you're free to use NPM modules on the server. It's simply just a wrapper. So then there is database API. This is pretty new, actually. If you're coming from Ruby or Rails or any sort of other background, any sort of web application development background, this you'll be pretty surprised by this database everywhere concept. We'll talk about it in much detail later. Then there is latency compensation. This is also a part of database everywhere. This essentially means that let's say I'm on an application and I'm updating something right now. So whatever I update, it's shown on my screen instantly, before it actually, you know, gets saved to the database, and before the server sends me any sort of response, it's immediately updated on my screen. So it sort of makes the app more responsive and snappy. Then if it checks for the server's response, and then, you know, it patches up whatever's shown on the screen. And there is full stack reactivity. Full stack reactivity means that everything in Meteor is event driven. So when the user clicks a button or when the user submits a form, that's when, you know, things start to happen. and there is embrace the ecosystem. So Meteor is open source. It's built on top of open source technologies. I mean, it uses Node.js, and as for its database, it uses MongoDB, which is again open source. So as you know, these open source technologies, as they evolve, so Meteor evolves with them. It's pretty new. It's constantly in flux. Lots of people contribute to it. It's still 0.6.x, so stuff keeps changing and stuff keeps breaking. So you need to keep updated with it. Simplicity equals productivity. So what this means is that Meteor gives you a very clean API. It's very well documented. So the core principle of Meteor is that the client and the server code should act in the same manner. Obviously, you won't be doing any DOM manipulation in the server, and you won't be doing any sort of sending emails from the client or any stuff like that. But essentially, the API should be in sync at both the client and the server levels. So data on the wire. So what this means is that the server only sends you JSON data. I mean, it only sends you documents across the wire. It doesn't send you JavaScript. It doesn't send you CSS. So after the initial page load, once all your CSS and once all your JavaScript files are loaded, after that, it's not the client's responsibility. It's not the server's responsibility to create HTML for you. That your client has to do that. I mean, your client code has to use whatever data the server sends you, and then create HTML and put it up on the screen. Why this is helpful is that this makes your applications much faster. So you're not sending images, you're not sending hundreds of lines of CSS, so you're not sending JavaScript again and again. So you save on a couple hundred KBs, so your application is more responsive and faster. So single language, this we've already talked about, it's JavaScript everywhere, rejoice. So then yeah, database everywhere. So what happens is that at every time, so Meteor uses MongoDB on the back end. We'll talk about MongoDB in detail later, but right now just understand that it's some sort of a permanent data storage. So at every time, Meteor sort of mimics whatever data is in that MongoDB into your client's storage. So at every time the data that's in your actual persistent storage is sort of mimicked in your client. So when the server pushes some sort of change, so the change is patched up into your client's database, and when the user updates something, it's instantly transferred to your client's database, and then it's sent across the wire, and the server actually patches that change into your actual MongoDB. So it sort of keeps two states, so one on the server, which is the actual permanent storage, and one on the client, which is something called mini Mongo, which is sort of a fork of Mongo, but it's not a complete implementation of Mongo, but it's somewhat in sync with your actual MongoDB database. So your client, so this is sort of the default settings, right? You don't really want your production applications, you don't really want your client to have full database access, right? You don't want your clients to do any sort of stuff with your database. You want your server to do all your permanent data storage, and your client should just call functions or whatever to make that happen, right? So this is just the default settings. This makes it very easy to prototype, actually. These are like prototyping tools, right? I mean, this database everywhere functionality is because of two packages. Think of packages as plugins. So it's because of two plugins. One is called the auto-publish, and one is called the insecure. So it's because of these two plugins that your client or your browser has entire access to your database. But once we remove these two plugins or two packages, so then your client stops having access to your database, and then you need to tell your client what access. You need to specify what access your client has to your actual database. So these are just prototyping tools. We'll see these in action, and then you'll sort of understand why Meteor has these defaults, because it sort of saves a lot of time, and it helps you really prototype stuff really fast. Latency compensation. So what I talked about this before, but what it means is that let's say I'm updating a post. I've created a new post. I've hit submit. So what happens is that my screen is that post is shown on my screen instantly. That is because Mongo maintains a client database, right? So that has immediate access. That client you don't need to wait for that record to go into the server. Wait a couple of milliseconds for that to process, and then wait a couple of milliseconds for that data to come back. So because you have immediate access on the client, immediate access to the post, so my browser window is updated immediately. And then in the background, Meteor sends the request back to the server. The server checks, if it's allowed, and it puts it back into the persistent storage, and then it responds back. So let's say, you know, your internet got disconnected somewhere, or let's say you were not allowed to put that post in. So what happens is that your client database is again patched to match your server database, and then your UI is also updated automatically, so that post gets removed. So then there is full stack reactivity, which just means that everything is event driven. The server code, the views changing, everything happens when user does something. And then there is embrace the ecosystem. It's open source, it's built on Node and Mongo. So as these tools improve, so Meteor improves with them. So like I said, right, there's one API. There's like a very consistent API on the client and on the server, both sides. So the API is somewhat similar. So if it doesn't take much time to pick it up. So actually, that's one of the biggest best thing about Mongo, best thing about Meteor. It's that, you know, it's very easy to pick up. So you can just browse through the documentation, and then, you know, you can actually start building your own applications. It's very simple. It's very consistent. So, you know, it doesn't take much of a learning curve. So does everyone have Meteor running? It's still not working, is it? So while that installation is happening, let's just talk about some Meteor internals, you know, what makes Meteor tick. Then when the download is complete, then, you know, we'll actually start building an application. Okay. So, okay, Meteor essentially is composed of two things. One is called packages, and one is the command line tool. So packages, think of packages, if you're from Ruby, think of packages as Ruby gems. If you're from Node, think of them as NPM modules. If you've not used anything and you have no idea what I'm talking about, then think of them as jQuery plugins, right? So these are encapsulated bits of JavaScript code. You just put them into your application, and, you know, you run one or two lines of code, and then you get that additional functionality. So that's what plugins, that's what packages are. So there are five types of packages in Meteor. We'll talk about them in detail. Then there is a command line tool. So command line tool is similar to Rake or Jake. So what this does is that it lets you interact with your application via the command line. It lets you interact with the MongoDB database that runs for your application. It lets you view your logs, the application logs. It lets you view your application logs. It lets you deploy your application. So it's a command line tool for that. It's also used for pre-processing. So let's say you have some coffee script, or you have some SAS or LESS files. So it lets you, this command line tool pre-processes them and converts them into JavaScript or CSS, and then, you know, puts it back into your browser. So yeah, the command line tool, so it does all the background processing. It converts all your coffee and LESS files into CSS and JavaScript. So you can actually create your own, there is this bundler API that Meteor provides, so you can actually create your own packages, and you can hook into this command line process. If let's say SCSS is not supported, I mean, SCSS, there's no package for SCSS right now, but let's say you want to build an application with SCSS. So you can hook into this command line, you can hook into this bundler API that Meteor provides, and write your own code to convert that SCSS into CSS and then use it. So this also lets you deploy your application and view logs. We'll be deploying an application. Let's first create an application and run some code, and then we'll look at deploying and viewing logs. So now we come to packages. Packages are pretty important. Everything in Meteor sort of happens because of these packages. So there are five types of packages. One is core package. Then there is smart packages, atmosphere packages, NPM modules, and local packages. So core packages are used in every Meteor application. So think of these as the piece of code that makes Meteor tick, right? So these are packages like web app, which do all the HTTP processing. There is a package called templates, which does all your handlebar templates. We'll get to that later, but think of these as the code that makes your Meteor application tick. So these are like essential. You can remove them and write your own code instead, but for now we'll just use the core packages as it is. So then there are smart packages. So Meteor provides around 3740 additional packages. So these are not used in every application, but you can optionally use them. You can put them into your application and start using them. So these are for stuff like sending emails, using CoffeeScript, or using authentication. So Meteor has a pretty solid user account system. We'll be taking a look at that later. But there's a smart package for user account. You can just drop that in, add one line of code, and you'll have a whole fully functional user accounts system ready. So then there is atmosphere packages. So right now, you or I cannot contribute to the smart packages library because that API is not live yet. But there is a community supported package library and a repository management system called Meteorite. So what Meteorite does is that it lets you create your own packages and put them into this atmosphere package repository. So if you go to atmosphere.meteor.com, I'll just show you. So this has like packages for everything you can think of, right? I mean, there are like hundreds and hundreds of packages. So these are all community supported. You can use this code into your own Meteor application. So you can find packages for everything that you can think of. If there are no packages here, you can easily create using the API that this provides. So Atmosphere and this Meteorite, this is going to come into Meteor itself in 1.0. So right now it's 0.06, right? So in the roadmap, it says that Atmosphere is going to be incorporated into Meteor core itself. Right, NPN modules. So NPN modules don't work out of the box. I mean, it's not like you can just drop that NPN module into your Meteor application and just start using it. So there are some amount of configuration involved. We're not going to be talking about NPN modules here because it's pretty deep, and you'll probably need to look into the documentation for that. But yeah, you can use it. I mean, there are a couple of great tutorials out there that'll help you use NPN modules. Then there are local packages. So yeah, you can create your own package. I mean, if there are no packages in Atmosphere, if there are no packages in the smart package library, you can just create your own packages, put them into a folder called packages, use the package API that Meteor has, and then just start using your own package. So these are like local jQuery plugins that you create. No, you have to install this right now. Then you can strip away the stuff that you don't want, but you have to install it as a whole, and then you can strip away the stuff that you don't want, but I don't think you can install it as an NPN module.
Because if I'm using something like a third party poster, right? Somebody gives me a Node.js.
So there what you need to do is you need to strip away all the core packages, and just maybe let's say you don't want any sort of server running. So you remove the web app package. If you don't want any sort of reactivity in your application, you remove the live data. If you don't want any sort of CSS processing, you remove something called Spark. You can install the whole thing, and then you can strip away the core packages to help you with just what you want. So yeah, you can deploy it you don't need to have to specifically deploy it to Meteor or whatever. You can bundle your application. It bundles everything into a regular Node.js application, and then you can push it to Heroku or Node.js 2 or whatever.
That is
possible. I'll just show you. When we get to that. Okay. So now is Meteor running everywhere?
Yeah.
You can just verify by running Meteor --- version, and that should give you the version. Show of hands. How many have got this to work? I guess some people are still left. It's already installed. Okay, so now we're going to create an application. Shall we create? I mean, is everything?
0.5 is okay?
Yeah, I think it should be okay. Yeah, or you can just do Meteor update, but yeah, I think it should be okay. So shall we create an application now? Yeah, okay. So just type Meteor. So just to Meteor create contacts, because we're going to be building a contacts manager application. So just to Meteor create contacts, this will create an application for you. So how many of you have got this to work? I mean, if this shows up, then you know it's running and everything's fine. Cool. So now just cd or move into your contacts, the directory that it just created, just move into that and let's start the server. So starting the server is pretty easy. You just run Meteor, that's it, and hit enter. Now we go to localhost 3000. It's okay. So do you have this? Okay, great. So just stop me if I'm going too fast, or if you couldn't get this to work. No, you can specify the port actually. You can, let me just show that to you. Meteor, I think it's Meteor dash dash port. Remember actually, let me just.
Yeah,
default is 3000. Okay. So now let's look at the code that it created. Huh? So I think you're gonna find a few things that are pretty different. So there's nothing in the CSS file. We can ignore that for now. We're not gonna be writing any CSS right now. So there's this contacts.html file, and then there is contacts.js file, which is again kind of funky. So let's look at the contacts.html file first. So the first thing that you'll notice, I just want you to take a quick note of the things that you find different, you know, things that are not there in a regular application that you write. So there's no doc type. So there's no HTML, root level HTML element. So there are no script tags. There's no CSS import, you know, links to your style sheets. Then there is something, then there is this double curly braces, and then there is something inside of that. Then there is a root level tag called template, which has the same name as that we use in body. So is everyone following? And then inside of that template, you have something inside double curlies again, which probably looks like a variable, but we'll get to that. So this is all there is in the HTML file. Now let's go to the JavaScript file. Okay. So here, so there's an if flag called if Meteor is client, and then there is if Meteor is client. So as you know, you could probably understand, you know, some part of code is running inside of the client and some part of it is running inside the server. So then, you know, so here we created something called a template with the name of hello, and here we're seeing that template dot hello dot greeting. Okay, so now here we had this variable called hello, and then here we are setting that variable called hello to something, which is why we are getting welcome to contacts. Let's just see if this is how it works. Let's just change this to something else and then come back to the browser, and you know, then it changes. Okay, so now you have a rough idea, right, how things work. So there is something called a template. You know, you put, there are some variables inside of that. Then in your JavaScript file, you sort of give those variables whatever values you want. We'll talk about templates in much more detail later, but right now just get a feel of how things work in Meteor. So then, you know, there is also this events hash. We'll come to that later. Okay, so there's one more thing that I want you to take a look at. Okay, okay. So if you just yeah.
You changed that to welcome to Meteor, right?
Mm-hmm. Okay, there's something else here, huh? So there is this thing called, there is an H1 tag called hello world, right? So I'm just going to change it to Meteor. I just want you to also change it to Meteor, whatever you want, and then go back to your browser. Don't refresh it. You know, you'll see that it automatically refreshes itself. Did everyone see that? So just you know, anywhere in this H1 tag, just change it to whatever you want. Just save the file, and then come back to your browser. You will notice a cool thing, right? You don't have to refresh your server. You refresh your browser every time; it automatically restarts itself. Okay. So now let's move on. Okay, so we've created an application now. I mean, that's all there is to creating an application. We've looked at whatever code that generated. Now let's start actually using some packages, because as I said, right, I mean, in Meteor, you can't get too far without using any sort of package. So we're going to be using, let's just see what all packages Meteor provides us with. I'm just going to open up a new tab, and I'm going to type Meteor list. So now you see a list of packages. So there is something called accounts based, which is for the user account system. So then there is Amplify, App Cache, and emails, which we'll be taking a look at later. And there is HTTP, and there's Backbone also. So yeah, so there's one thing that I want to point out right here. So Meteor is not like Angular or Backbone. It's not a client-specific framework. It's a full-stack framework. So you don't need to use Ruby or anything on the server and then use Backbone or Angular on the client. So it's a full stack framework. You write everything. You build your own whole application. You build, you know, everything inside of Meteor. So that's one key difference between other libraries and Meteor. So there is jQuery, which we can use if you want, but we won't be using right now. So the one we'll be using right now is Bootstrap. So because we won't be writing much CSS, we're going to be using a CSS framework from front end framework from Twitter called Bootstrap. So the way we add that is very simple. We just do Meteor add. And then, you know, you type Bootstrap. Is everyone following along? Have you guys added this? Yeah, you can stop the server, add this. So has everyone added this Bootstrap? And then when you come back to your browser, you'll notice that, you know, the fonts have already changed, so you don't need to even refresh. So once you add a package, it's automatically, Meteor automatically listens for that and changes whatever. So the fonts have automatically changed. So this is how you add packages. We'll look at adding more packages. We'll look at adding, you know, some other stuff later. But right now, let's just get on with it. So this is the hot code reload part that I talked about. You noticed how Meteor automatically updates itself, right? How it automatically restarts the server. So this is something called hot code reload. So what it essentially means is that Meteor keeps listening for changes in your HTML, CSS, and JavaScript files. Whenever it detects any change, it automatically restarts the server and refreshes your browser. So the other thing is that in hot code reload, it actually preserves your state. So we haven't talked about sessions yet, but I'll just remind me to talk about preserving state then. So what it essentially means that when a user is using an application and then, you know, you push some changes, so the user has like the minimum friction. He doesn't have any sort of thing thrown into his face. So Meteor automatically preserves his state and then, you know, gradually adds more stuff to it. Yeah, so the load order. So you might have noticed, right? I mean, there's no script tags. So how do you maintain them? How do you manage your dependencies, right? I mean, if you've used required.js or something like that, you'll know that, you know, so that these files should be loaded. Can everyone read this, right? When can you read this? So you'll know that, you know, some files need to be loaded first, some file needs to be loaded after something. So you need some sort of dependency management, right? So here it just loads everything automatically. So how do you specify which files you want first? Let's say you're using jQuery and you're using some file that depends on jQuery. So how do you tell Meteor to, you know, load jQuery before loading anything else? So that's when this load order comes in. So anything that you put inside a lib directory, so if you create a lib directory and the files that you put in there, those files get loaded first. So the lib directory is for, you know, your jQuery or, you know, whatever libraries that your other code depends on. So any file that matches main dot something. So let's say you have a main.js or let's say you have main.html. So these two files will be loaded last. These two files will be loaded after everything else is loaded. And then there are, then, you know, whatever files that you have inside of subdirectory, these are loaded before your files in the main directory. Let's say you have a file called lib and then you have a file called maybe jQuery. And then, you know, you have some other file inside of jQuery, maybe, you know, I don't know, maybe you have some other file inside of jQuery. The file that's inside of the jQuery folder, that'll be loaded first. Then the file inside jQuery folder will be loaded. Then the file in the root directory will be loaded. So it's deepest to shallowest. The file that's in the deepest location, that'll be loaded first, and then the file in the than the file that's in the shallowest location. So is everyone clear with this?
Files which do not have any dependencies.
You can just put them anywhere you want.
So the file which jQuery should be in the deepest directory.
Yeah, no, if there is some hard dependency, you should put it in the lib directory, because it will be loaded first. Okay? Does that make sense?
Okay. Inside lib directory also that order will
be. Yeah, inside lib directory also that order will be there. So within a directory, files are loaded in the alphabetical order. So a.js will be loaded before b.js. So yeah, this point is very important. So any file that is in the root directory, that's not in client or browser server directory, so any file that is in the root directory will be loaded on both the client and the server. So this is pretty new. I mean, you know, with Node.js you can write JavaScript on the server, and then you know you can write JavaScript on the client also, right? But the thing with Meteor is that you know you can actually share code between the client and the server. Let's say you've got some validations. Let's say you've got some form validations. So the same form validation rules you can use on the actual form on the client, and you can use the same form validation rules in the server when you're actually putting that stuff into your database. So you can actually share code between your client and the server. So any file that you put in the root directory will be loaded on the client and the server. So this is pretty key. So we can actually even take a look at this. So there is this contacts.js file, right? So I'm just gonna go outside and put a console.log here. And then when I come back to my server, I'll see this logging here, right? I mean, I just logged it from this file. So it's logged into the server. And now when I come back to my browser and I check my browser's console, yeah, I see the logging here again. So any file that you put in the root directory will be loaded on both the client and the server. Okay, so now you know that, you know, any file that you put will be loaded both on the client and the server, but you don't want your DOM manipulation to go inside the server, and you don't want your server-side code to go into a client. So how do you separate your code? To separate your code, you just saw in the file that Meteor created for us. So there were two flags, right? If Meteor.isClient and if Meteor.isServer. So this lets you separate out your code. But this is not, you know, optimum, right? I mean, in every file, you don't want to write if Meteor.isClient and if Meteor.isServer, right? You want some other way to manage your client and server code. So the way you do that is you create a server and a client, like client a folder. So any code that you put inside a folder called server will only be run on the server, and any code that you put inside a folder called client will only be run on your browser. Okay, so this is how you separate out your code. Okay, so now we come to templates. So you might have noticed, right, the HTML that you write in a regular application and the HTML that's there in this Meteor app is pretty different, right? There are three root level tags actually. One is head, one is body, and then there's this template tag, right? So in any single page application, so how it usually works is that, you know, when you're creating an application with Ruby on Rails, or if you're creating an application with PHP, right? So you create some sort of an ERB file, you create a template called an ERB template, or you create a .ctp template, that the server puts all the data into that template and then, you know, renders the HTML file, HTML page to the browser, right? But in a single page application, the server is only sending you data. You're on one single page and the server keeps sending you data for the next page or whatever. So it's the client's responsibility to keep changing the views, right? So the way you change the views is with templates. So let's say you have an about page. So you create an about template that has the, you know, everything with your about everything that's, you know, you want to show on your about page. Then let's say there is a contact us page. So instead of creating a contact us page, you create a template called contact us, and you replace everything that's in the about template with the contact template. So does that make sense? I mean, why you want to use templates instead of creating HTML file? So the way you create templates in Meteor is pretty simple. So Meteor gives you a root level tag called template. This is not a regular HTML tag. So this is just something that Meteor gives you. And then, you know, when you're actually running the application, Meteor compiles everything that's inside of this template into a JavaScript function. So you create a template tag, give it a name. This name should be unique. You can't have two templates with the name of hello. So this name is very important. So give it a unique name, and you put whatever HTML you want to put inside of that. And then when you want to call that, then when you want to render that template, just use a, so Meteor uses handlebars. So if you've used handlebars before, you'll be pretty comfortable here. So just use a double curly braces and then a greater than sign, and then follow that with the name of the template that you want to render. So this whole syntax, so this is for actually rendering any template. So this is pretty key. So this is called the partial syntax. We'll take a look at that later, but we'll be using this almost everywhere. So just keep a note of this. So what this essentially means is that you're telling Meteor to render, to replace this line with anything, with any template that has a name of hello. So does that make sense? No, you can change your templating library, but handlebars is built in, so sort of it's the default that comes with it. But you can use, you can create your own templates if you want. You know, you can use Jade or whatever you want. But the thing is that you might need to do some sort of processing on the JavaScript end. So you might need to call a function called meteor.render, and then inside of that render function, you might want to specify what all you want to change, and then you know you want to put that into your HTML. So you want to, you can change that. You can change your templating engine, but you might need to do a bit of processing for that. Okay, so this partial syntax is clear, right? I mean, you can just this replaces anything that's in any template with the name of hello with the actual contents of the template. Okay, so there are three root level tags. There's no HTML, there's no root level HTML tags, so there are just three root level tags: head, body, and template. Yeah, and the other thing is that, you know, you can have multiple HTML files. You don't need to put all your HTML into this one file. So you can have multiple HTML files. Then what Meteor does is that it concatenates all the head tags into one. It concatenates all the body tags into one, and then sends it out to your browser. Okay. So yeah, templates. Templates are just regular HTML expressions that you write. So the only thing is that it lets you embed variables, or it lets you embed expressions into it. So without handlebars or without any sort of templates, you'll probably be doing, you know, a name plus dot is, you know, something like that. But with handlebars or with any sort of templating library, it gets much clearer. You know, it gets easier to read. So we just looked at creating a template. Just create a template tag, give it a unique name, and just render it wherever you want. With the partial syntax, right? So so there are three the templates give you three sort of additional things over HTML, over regular HTML tags. So one is the partial syntax, which we just looked at for rendering any other template that you've already created. Then there is expression syntax. So what this essentially means is that so here you see this, right? Double curly braces with greeting inside of this. So this greeting is a variable. So this variable gets its value from the JavaScript file, but the syntax of having double curly braces with a variable in between actually tells handlebars or tells Meteor to just replace this with whatever is the value of the variable. Is that okay? Does that make sense? Okay. And then you have block helpers. So we haven't looked at block helpers anywhere here. So but what block helpers do is that it lets you change the flow of commands inside of your template. So you can have something like if your regular if statement, right? You know, you can check if the user is logged in, then you know you show him this template. If the user is not logged in, show him, you know, something like access denied or something. So you can also iterate over objects. Let's say you have an array. You have an array of contacts. In our application itself, we'll be having an array of contacts, right? So we want some sort of way to iterate over all the whole array and render a template for each of our contacts. So that's for that you need something like each. So the syntax is, if you haven't used handlebars before, the syntax will be pretty new. So for that, everything in handlebars goes inside of this double curly, right? So just keep a mental note of that. So whenever you see double curly, so just think of it as handlebars. So inside of your, if you want to use any of the block helpers, so the way you do that is use a double curly, then a pound sign, and then if. And then, you know, you give it whatever the condition that you want to check. So let's say I'm using current user here. Current user is something that Meteor gives us to check if a user is logged in or not. So I'm checking if a user is logged in, I want to show him something here. If he's not, I'm going to show him that, you know, access is denied or something like that. So this is how you use a block helper. And then there is unless, which essentially means if not. So if not new user, then show him this. This is just a nicety. You can also use if here and, you know, reverse the conditions. Then there is each. We're doing a double curly, then a pound each contacts, and then we're rendering each contact. So this is how you do that. So we're going to be working a lot with if and each. So just take a mental note of this right now. Then when we write the code, it'll get a lot easier. Right. So we talked about how you can use variables inside of your handlebar templates, right? So, but we need to give that variable a value, right? I mean, somewhere your handlebar templates is nothing, right? Templates just take some HTML, it takes some data, it mashes them together and puts it on the screen. That is what a template does, right? So you have your HTML inside of that template tag. So to give it some data, we need some sort of way to, you know, assign some data to it. So the way you do that is with template help functions. So what Meteor does is that, you know, it reads all your code, and then it looks for all those template tags, and then, you know, it finds a name along with it, right? You use template name equal to hello, right? So then what it does is that it compiles that into a JavaScript function. It compiles that and then gives you a global object called template. Then you can use dot notation on that template object to access a particular template. Let's say you've created a template with the name of hello, right? Like so. So then the way you access that template from your JavaScript code is with template dot hello. So does this make sense? Because this is going to be the key when we work, right? So let's say we've created a template called header. Template name equals header. Then we put a h1 inside of that. So the way you access that header template from your JavaScript file is with template dot header. And then whatever variables you want to assign, you assign it to that to template dot template name. Okay? Yeah, you can just, you can, let's say you have a template called hello and then you have a template called greeting. So just do template dot hello dot variable name equal to whatever, then template dot greeting dot variable name equal to whatever. You can just share the same options, doesn't it? So for that, you'll probably be using a collection for that. You know, if that JSON is coming, it probably is coming from your server, right? Maybe not. Okay, if it's not, maybe what you can do is you can define that JSON as a reactive data source. We'll get to that later, but you can define it as a reactive data source, and then, you know, you can assign it to both the templates. Then when that reactive data source changes, these will be automatically recomputed. Okay, we'll get to that. Yeah. So then there is template events. So I said, right? I mean, Meteor is event driven. You want some sort of way to listen for click events, you know, submit events. Usually what happens in any sort of applications is a user submits a form. So I mean, or, you know, user clicks a button. So you need some sort of way to hook into that event. So the way you do that is, let's say you have a template called hello, right? You do template.hello.events, and then inside of that you provide a hash. This is called an event hash. So how this works is that as the key you give it a string. And then, you know, inside of that string you separate the event and the target element with a space. So let's say I want to click on an input element. So I will do click input. Let's say I want to submit a form. I will do submit form. Does that make sense? Let's say there's a button called button with an ID of button. So what I will do is I will do click hash button. You use your regular HTML, regular CSS identifiers for that target element, and then you can listen for click, double click, key press, you know, you like your regular jQuery stuff. Does that make sense? And then the way you hook into this event is you give it a function that will be executed when that event happens. So this function gets two arguments. So one is E, which is the event object. I mean, the first argument is the event object. This is very similar to jQuery. This will have all your current target and your target and, you know, what sort of event it was. And the second one is pretty new. So the second argument that this function gets is the template context. So I mean, this is essentially, you know, what template triggered this event. Let's say I have many list items. So when you click on the third list item, so this will have the data for the whole template that this function was listening on. Does that make sense? We'll get to that when we see some code for it. But right now, just know that inside of an events hash, this is how you create event listeners.
You can use the classes and IDs.
Yeah, you can use classes and IDs. So just replace click dot button or dot or hash button or whatever you want. You can use your regular CSS.
Binding, like,
yeah, there is dynamic binding, so it automatically listens to that. And there are no zombie views. If you're from Backbone, you might have heard of zombie views. So Meteor takes care of cleaning itself up after after something gets destroyed, so there are no zombie views here. Okay, so reactivity. Okay, so template is like one core part of Meteor, then the reactivity is like what makes that template tick. So what react, is anyone familiar with reactive programming? So what reactive programming means is that let's say there's a function, right? I mean, that function adds two values. Let's say sum equals a plus b. So in regular programming, what happens is that let's say you've added 7 plus 5 and that sum variable stores the value of 12. So then if you change the value of either of those, either if you change 7 to 10 or if you change 5 to whatever, that sum variable still has the value of 12, right? That doesn't get changed. But in reactive programming, what happens is that let's say there are two, let's say you're adding a plus b into some variable called sum. Let's say you've changed b to 12 or something like that. So the sum gets automatically recomputed. So that is what reactive programming means. So what this essentially means is that you write some code in imperative, in an imperative way. Then it is recalculated whenever the data changes. Does that make sense? Okay. So in how Meteor, this is like one of the key components of Meteor. So how Meteor implements this is with two things. So one is reactive data sources. The other is with reactive context. So what reactive data sources means is that this set of data will emit an event whenever it changes, right? And then reactive context listens for that change event and then recomputes itself. Does that make sense? So this is how the whole reactivity the whole topic of reactivity is handled in Meteor. So the data sources, the reactive data source is something that whenever it changes, it sort of emits an event. Okay, I've changed. And then reactive context listens for that change. Okay, my data has changed, so I need to recompute myself. So it recomputes itself. Okay, so where you'll be seeing reactivity a lot is when you combine something like collections. So collections are a way to talk to your MongoDB database. So the collection is one of your reactive data sources. So whenever your collection changes, you'll notice that your templates get re-rendered automatically. So this is because of this reactivity. Collection is a reactive data source and template is a reactive context. So collection, just think of collections as a JSON document that is coming from your server. So whenever that JSON document changes, so this template, which is a reactive context, will know that okay, my data has changed. I need to recompute myself and I need to re-render myself on the client. So then it re-renders itself and then you see a live update. So does that make sense? Okay, so that is how reactivity is handled in Meteor. So I know this is pretty abstract, but we'll take when we write some code, it'll get a lot easier. So session storage. Okay, so let's say session storage is a key value store. So think of it as a global communication channel or a global communication bus. Let's say you want to store which page the user is on right now. Let's say you want to store what the ID of the currently clicked item is or whatever. So that you put it into a session storage. So session storage is reactive. What this means is that whenever a session changes, if there's a view attached to that session, that also changes. Let's say I've set a session variable to page number 1, and then somehow after some processing, that session variable has been updated to page number 2. And let's say I've linked a view to that session variable. What that view will do is that, okay, the view will listen, okay, I was on page number 1, now my data has changed to page number 2. Okay, so I need to recompute myself and I need to re-render the document to page number 2. Okay, does that make sense? Okay, so that is session storage in action for you. So it's very simple. We'll take a look at this. We'll be using a lot of session storage. So it's very simple. If you just want to store some sort of key and you want to keep track of that value, let's say whenever that value changes, you want to recompute something, let's say you want to change the view according to that to whatever stored in that session variable, so for that you use session storage. So interacting with session storage is very easy. You can just do session.set, then give it whatever variable name you want, and then give it whatever value, and then when you want to get that value back, you do session.get and give it that variable name. There is also session.equals, which checks for the equality. So let's say what this line does is that it checks if current task has a value of learn Meteor or not. It returns to true or false. Okay. So now before we get to persistent data storage, let's just write some code. Huh? We've discussed a lot of stuff, and a lot of it might be pretty abstract, but let's just write some code to see some of it in action. So everyone is at this stage, right? We've added Bootstrap, and everyone is at this stage, right? Yeah? Okay, so now I'm just going to remove all my contacts.html file, and then I'm going to add a head. These are just some Bootstrap tags that I'm adding. If you don't want to add this, you know, it doesn't make much difference. It just makes your page look somewhat better. So I've created a template called header, and then I've rendered that template called header inside of my body. Okay. So now inside of this header, I'm going to create a row, and I'm going to create a well because I like wells, and then I'm going to create h1. Okay, so that's all I'm doing here. So what I've done here, let me just see if it works. Yeah, it works. Okay, so what I've done here is that I've created a template called header, and then I've rendered that header here. So other than that, there is an h1 tag called contacts inside of that header template, but other than that, whatever markup I've used is because of Bootstrap. It's not something that Meteor requires. It's not something that you have to type it out. You can use it, you know, very well without adding any of that. Yeah, so right now I'm using Bootstrap 2.3. I'm not using Bootstrap 3. So because the smart package that automatically comes in with Meteor hasn't been updated, so it still uses Bootstrap 2.3. But you can use Bootstrap 3 if you want using an Atmosphere package. I'll show that later. But right now, since I'm using Bootstrap 2.3, I'm using that fluid tag. Yeah, okay. So we'll get to that, you know, when we get to Atmosphere packages. Yeah, sure. When we get to Atmosphere packages, we'll look at how we can use Bootstrap 3. So is everyone with me? Does everyone see this well and an h1 tag? Now what I want to do is I want to show a list of contact. Okay. So now what I want to do is I want to show a list of contacts, all my contacts, right? So for that, I'm going to create a new template. This is going to be pretty, you know, this is going to be like the one that we just created. I'm going to call it contact list. And I'm also going to render it. Inside of my body. Okay. So inside of this contact list, what I'm going to do is I'm going to create a UL element, UL an unordered list. Then I'm going to each over something called contacts. And then I'm going to, inside of that each loop, I'm going to create an LI element. And I'm going to put a variable called name inside of that. So is this part clear? Should I bump up the font size? Okay, so this part is pretty, I mean, we're going to be using this each a lot. So just tell me, you know, if this is not clear. So we're going to be iterating over an array. Let's just think of contacts as an array. We'll assign that value later, but right now just think of it as an array. So we're going to be iterating over that array, and then we're going to be rendering an li, with a inside of which we'll show the we will show a variable called name. No. You can you have to put a space after it, but not before it, I think. Okay. Double curly and then a greater than sign. Greater than. Has everyone written, you know, the code till here? Okay. So now, you know, you see that, you know, you're iterating over something called context, right? But we haven't specified what that variable is anywhere. So we're going to do that inside of our JavaScript file. So I'm going to just remove everything. Then I'm going to do if meteor.is client, because we're only working on the client side right now. Okay, so I'm going to do. I'm going to write whatever code I want inside of an if statement, which checks if the environment is currently the client and not the server. Okay, so here I'm going to create a variable called contacts, and this is going to be an array, and inside of that I will put some objects with a name of, let's say, you know, whatever. Okay, so here's the funky part. So I know that I have a template called contact list, right? So I want to assign a variable called contacts that is inside of that contacts list. So the way I access that is by calling template.contactList.contacts equal to, and then I'm going to return something inside of this. Okay, so does this make sense? That's not necessary actually, but why you want to do that, actually it'll also work if you just specify contacts here like so. But why we want to do that is because we want that, if let's say something inside of that contacts array has changed, we want that whole function to recompute, right? So we want that contacts variable that we've assigned to the template also to change. So the way that changes is when the function linked to that is recomputed, when that function is again recalculated. So for that we just need to return it from a function so that the whole function is recomputed again. It is going to recompute the whole function that is linked to it. Now it'll add one more because you're not doing any sort of manipulation on the client, right? Now what you're doing is that you're just changing that variable and, you know, restarting your server. But later we'll see an example. Let's say we're adding some contact, then dynamically. So now when we come back to the browser, we should see that two items that we just added. Is that okay? Everyone's got this? Any errors, anything? HTML. Should I proceed? Yeah. Okay. So now I'm going to do something else here. So Okay, so now I've done something else here. So I've created a session variable. I've created a session variable called contacts, and I've assigned that contacts to the array that we just created. And then inside of our function, I'm returning that session variable by doing return session.getContacts. So why I'm doing that, we'll just take a look at that. You know, when we start adding something to our array, we want some sort of reactivity going on. So for that, I'm just right now just create a session variable, and then just put that contacts array into that session variable. So we're doing this because session is a reactive storage, right? So whenever something inside of that session variable changes, that template will be automatically recomputed. So that's why we're doing that. Okay, so now. So now we've been able to show some amount of some contacts here, right? So now what we want is we want a form that sort of adds contacts to this, right? Yeah. No, you still need to make a function. Because that function is again recalculated, not that data source. That data source just tells whoever's listening that okay, I've changed. Then that context listens for that change and then recomputes this function that is linked.
So the data source also has to be reactive. The variables used inside the functions, inside the function which is.
That is the context. Yeah.
That should also be.
Yeah, that is a reactive context, yes. Okay. So, does everyone still have it working? I mean, are there other two things showing up? Okay, so now we can actually do something here. So, we open up this JavaScript console on your browser and just do session. So now we're getting something back on the client also. So we've just set that. So here we've just set a session variable called contacts and, you know, assigned it that array, right? So now when we come back to our browser and then we do a session.getContacts from our console, we'll see the same two objects shown here. Okay. So now we can actually do something else here. We can just do session.set, and now I'm going to change that array. See, so what I've done is I've set that contacts session variable to a different array. So I've created an array with just one object called with a different name. So, and as soon as I hit enter, so that the view also changed, and you know, instead of showing the two list items, it's now showing just one list item with this new name. Can everybody see that in action? You just try setting a different variable. So this is reactivity, right? I mean, you didn't write any sort of listeners, you didn't bind any sort of event callbacks, you know, where you had to check, okay, if this is changed, okay, I need to do this now. So a Meteor automatically handled that for you. So when you changed a reactive data source, so the view that was linked to it automatically got re-rendered. Okay, so this is going to be the core. So similar to session variable is not permanent, right? This is not getting stored into any sort of database or anything. So if you refresh, it'll go away. It'll come back to the original state. So this is reactivity at its core, right? I mean, when you change the data, the views automatically change. And this is how it is going to work with collections also. So collections are a way to store data permanently into your database. So when that data that is in your database changes, so the view also changes. When a view changes, then that change is automatically reflected into your database. So that is how it'll work for the permanent data storage also. So if this is clear, then you know we can also move on to persistent data storage.
Sessions are not
persistent. No, not on a hard refresh. But if you do so now we've already talked about sessions, right? So if you do a hot code reload, right? If you change something in your code, and then you know, let's say you're running a production application, you've changed something and then you've redeployed it. So if the user is on a session, let's say he's on page number one and he has a session of page number one set as, you know, if he has a session of page number one set to whatever value, that session will be sort of carried over when you do a hot code reload. That session will be preserved, but not on a hard reload. When you do a hard reload, that session will go away. Does anyone have any questions? Okay. Yeah. HTML file template name equal to header, the H capital, just change it to small header. No, it will automatically do that. Okay. Session dot get contacts. You're actually returning just this variable and not the session variable. So here you just do session dot get contacts. So what you're doing is you're setting a contact, right? You're setting a session variable, and then you need to return that session variable. Session dot get. Yeah. Now you run the code. Backslash here. The way you end backslash each. The way you end a tag is with backslash. So if you have an if tag, you similarly you'll do a backslash if to end it. Okay. So before we look into persistent data storage, let's do one thing. Let's have a form here, and when we hit submit on that form, let's update our session variable to actually add that element here. Then we know we'll look at how we can store that permanently to our database. Okay. So what we're going to do that is you can also do that very easily. So I'm going to render a new template here called add contact or something. Yeah, I think this should do. And then I'm going to create a new template. This routine should be pretty familiar now. And then inside of this add contact template, I'm going to add a form. This form will have an input with a type of text. Okay, class of name. Oh, sorry. Yeah, I guess that should be it. Okay. So here's what I have. I've created a template called add contact, template name add underscore contact, and then inside of that I have a form, and inside of that form there is an input field. Okay. Rendered that form here called add with a greater than sign and the name followed by it. we're just going to listen on the submit event. So, yeah, okay. Yeah, probably we should add. Yeah. Well, let's just add. I think this should be it, right? Following along? I mean, is there any problem, any errors? So everyone has this form up here, right? So what we want is when we click, so you know, when we type something and when we hit enter, when we submit, we want that name to show up here, right? So that's what we're going to do. So for that, we need to listen to some sort of submit event on this form, right? So I just talked about how you can add event listeners. So I'm just going to do that again here. So I know that I have a template called add contact. So I'm going to refer to that template by doing template.addContact, okay? And then I'm going to add an events hash, events map to it. Okay. So this is how I do that. So here's what I do. I do template.addContact.events. Okay? Okay, so here I do a submit on a form because I know that there is a form inside of that template. So I want to listen to submit events on that form. So for now I've just added an alert that says I'm submitting something, but I'll just replace that with some good code. Yeah, so we're listening to that event. So how we're doing that is here. So I've just added an events map on add contact, and then inside of that I'm listening for submit form. I mean, I'm listening for a submit event on that form, and then I'm adding a function that will get executed when that submit event occurs. And inside of that, we get two arguments, right? We get two parameters. One is the event object, which is the first argument, and then the second one is the template context. We'll look at template context, you know, in a bit, but right now we're doing e.preventDefault. Is everyone clear with this line, prevent default? So what we're doing is that when you submit a form, it automatically does a post or a get request, right? I mean, it reloads the form. That is what the usual flow is, right? We don't want that. We want to stay on this page. We just want some other processing to happen, so we just do a prevent default. You don't want the browsers or, you know, the default function to default event to happen. We just want that to stop, and we want our code to run. So for that we just do an e.preventDefault, okay? And then we're just doing an alert. Okay, instead of this alert, let's just actually console.log whatever there is inside of that t, right? I mean, log out the two parameters so that we know what we're talking about. Okay, so the first one is the event object. This is very similar to what the jQuery event object is, and you know what you get with jQuery. So the second one is pretty funky, right? The second one, there is something called a data, I mean, which is undefined right now, but we'll get to data in a bit when we're doing some sort of each loop or something. Then there is find. There's a function called find, and then there's a function called find all. Then there's first node and last node. Okay, so the find, we're going to be using the find lot. So find, think of find as your jQuery find, right? If you're familiar with that. So this is just a way to traverse the DOM and look for specific elements. Okay, so let's say you want to find that input element. So what you will do is you will do t.find. You will call this find function. And then, you know, you will give it input type equal text or whatever, you know, whatever CSS selector you want. You just give it inside of this find function, and then, you know, it will find that for you. This will just return one thing. So if you do find all, it will return all instances. Okay. So we're going to be using the find function a lot. So is that clear, everyone? Okay. So let's just take a look at that. So here's how I've done that, right? So I know that there is an input element inside of this. I've given it a class of full name, so I know that I can refer to it by calling t.find with a class name of full name. Is this part clear? So we just talked about the find function and how it can find specific DOM elements for you, right? So I'm just going to find an input element with a class of full name, and then I'm going to get its value. So is this clear? So now what we need to do is we need to set this value inside of our session variable. Okay. So here's what I've done. So I know that I have a session variable called contacts. I know that I need to get its value. So here's what I'm doing. I'm doing var contacts equal to session dot get contacts. Okay. I'm getting that array back. Then I'm pushing that new full name, the new name whatever that I've typed. I'm pushing that object inside of that contacts array as an object, and then I'm setting that contacts variable back to this new contacts. Right? Does this make sense? You can do it on one line actually. I just did it here, so it's more clear. Okay. Get this to work? Can you add a new element? Okay. So I'm just going to try it out for you once. Let's just say chain do, and then that chain do is added here. Okay. So this is how it is going to work with our permanent storage also. The flow will be exactly similar. So instead of session dot get, we'll be actually talking to our permanent storage using something called collections. Okay. We'll talk about that in a bit, but is session, anyway, is templates, adding events, is all of that clear? Okay. Yeah. The template. All the events. Yeah. Yes. Event map, yes. So shall we move on to permanent storage? Yeah. Okay. Just stop me if you have any doubts or anything. Okay. So now we come to persistent data storage, right? In any sort of application, you want some way to store data back into your database and get data from that database, right? So the way you do that in Meteor is with MongoDB. So right now only MongoDB is supported, but in the future there will be support for other databases. But MongoDB works out of the box with Meteor, and you can use it, without any sort of problems. So the thing with Meteor is that the client and the server share the same database API. I've talked about this before, but the client maintains a local cache or an in-cache copy of the actual database, right? So whenever you are doing any sort of processing. Let's say this was talking to some sort of form, right? Let's say this was talking to some sort of form, and I hit submit. So what will happen is that this Jane Doe will get added to my local database first, and then it will be reflected on my screen, and then the process will go on to my actual server. If it was okay, then it'll send me back. It'll patch. If it was not okay, it'll patch my client database with whatever was returned. Okay. So this is pretty key. So the server and the client share the same database API. So this, how it works is that the server publishes a set of JSON documents, and the client subscribes for that documents. So whenever the document changes, so this client subscription is also changed, and the UI is also changed accordingly, right? So the only JSON data flows between the server and the client. So this is key. So other thing is that the protocol this uses, because this is real time, the protocol that this uses is DDP, distributed data protocol. But yeah, we'll get to that later. But right now, just think of it as, you know, as the server sending some. If you're all familiar with JSON, right? It's an key value stuff. So the server just sends some sort of JSON data, and the client just listens for that. So, okay. So how many of you have used MongoDB before? How many of you know what Mongo is? Okay, great. But I'm just going to do a quick refresher. Mongo is schema-less, which means that before that, you know, Mongo is not like your traditional RDBMS. You know, you don't have your tables and stuff. So here you have something called your collections. Collections are somewhat similar to your tables. Collections can have multiple documents. Okay, so you have collections, and collections can have multiple documents. So each document is like a row. Okay, so and then inside of that document you have fields, which is like one attribute, right? So let's say you have you want to store user profiles, right? So you will have one collection called users. Inside of that you will have many documents called user 1, user 2, user 3. And then inside of that you'll have fields like name, age, or whatever. Okay, so that is how Mongo works. So it is somewhat similar, but it is not exactly, you know, you don't have your tables and your rows and your columns and stuff like that. So it is schema-less. So what this means is that one document does not have to, you know, all the fields of one document does not have to be present in the fields of the second document. Let's say the first document only has a name and an age, right? In a user's collection, let's say the first document only has a name and an age. The second document can have his whole resume there. You know, it can have his name, first name, last name, his work experience. You know, it can have everything there. So you don't have to sort of restrict yourself to only having because the first document had a name and a last name and nothing else. You don't have to restrict yourself to just that in the second document. Okay, so it is somewhat schema-less. So when you get data from Mongo database, what you get is instead of that whole array of objects, what you get is a cursor. So cursor gives you, think of it as, you know, a wrapper around that object, so you can interact with that actual data by calling some functions on that cursor. We'll take a look at cursors later. Okay. So MongoDB crash course. So yeah. So this is just going to be a very simple, you know, crash course into Mongo about how we can add, find, or, you know, in update fields. So the way you interact is, you know, to create a collection, just do db.collectionName. If I want to create a collection called users, I'll probably just do a db.users.find, okay? Or I'll just do a db.users.insert. I don't have to specifically create a collection. You can just start using it, and Mongo will create it on its own if it does not exist. Okay. So the way you do this is let's say we have a collection called users, and we want to find every user that have a specific age, right? Let's say an age of 21. So the way we do that is db.users.find, and then, you know, inside of that we'll provide an hash with a key, let's say an age, and then with the parameter which will be let's say 21. So if we do db.users.find, and inside of that we do age:21, only those records will be returned that have age of 21 set. So we can actually interact. I told you, right? You can interact with with Meteor's MongoDB instance by running a command line tool. So here's how you do. So open up a new tab and just type Meteor Mongo. So what this does is, you know, it opens up that MongoDB shell, and you can start interacting with it. So I'm going to do this. So here's what I've done. This is the first command, right? So I've done deep. Can everyone read this? So I've done db.users.insert, and then I've given it a JSON. Think of it as a JSON object, right? I've given it an object with a name and with a key and a value. Okay. So now this didn't give me any error. So I think, you know, it saved it back into the MongoDB database. So I can check that by doing. Okay. So when I do, if the way you think of db.users.find as doing a select star in your select star from users in your, if you're from SQL or, you know, if you are from any RDBMS experience, you'll do select star from users, right? So think of doing select db.users.find as doing just that. Okay, so this is return me the object that I just put in. Let's say I'm adding a new one, right? And then I do a find, so it'll give me two things that I just put in. Okay, so the, let's say I want to just find where the name is Bharani. So the way I do that is, now it just gives me where the name is Bharani. I know this is a very simple example, but I think it should, if you're not clear with any of these commands, just let me know. Yeah? Yeah? So what does it say? Your application should be running. Okay, so before you run Meteor Mongo, just make sure that your application is running, then open up a new tab and then run Meteor Mongo on that, okay? Like something. Just check the MongoDB. Yeah. I'll probably look into that and I'll just tell you. Yeah, from the top of my head, I don't think I can. HTML file? HTML? Yeah. The server is not running. This should be btn. Let's see if that changes anything. This should classical to, instead of button, just this one, just change it to btn. Just save it. Let's see what works. Okay. This value should be outside actually. Dot outside of that bracket, just do dot value. Now go back and your. Can you open up the console? No. It should be an object. So here, open up a curly brace. It should be a JSON object. Yeah. Now it should work. Should be inside of in quotes. Okay, so now bootstrap is also working, right?
Yeah.
Okay. Oh no, you need to do e.prevent default. Just do an
E, dot prevent default. No, just call this one. Yeah, excellent. Yeah, sure. Yeah, you should pass just 1 minute. Submit form E dot prevent default. Ah, this is pretty funky, huh? Just 1 minute, can you open up your HTML? Can you open up your HTML? Okay.
But this is based on directly.
Yeah, just can you go back there? This is pretty funky because this should not happen. Can you go back to your JavaScript plan? Yeah, that's okay. Open up your JavaScript console. Okay. Can you open your JavaScript? Add contact. It should be, I think, add contact, right? The it was called add contact. It's called add contact, right? Yeah. Now just check if it works. Is everyone clear about how you find and how you insert stuff into your database? Okay. Okay, so now let's say we want to update something, right?
Excuse me.
Yeah.
We have to definitely use the Meteor for the Mongoose shell.
I didn't get your question. Yeah, you could do that. I think you could do that. Yeah, I haven't tried doing that, but I think you can do that. Yeah, it's just a Mongo shell that is running in the background. You should be able to access it without any.
Because in this you didn't use the
connections.
The DB you want to access.
Mm-hmm.
The collection.
Yeah.
So generally, when we access MongoDB through Mongo, you specify which collection. You
yes,
want to
and
use.
Which port you're listening to, right? Yes, we didn't do anything.
Port also. The collection,
database.
Database.
Okay, okay.
Use something.
Mm-hmm.
In RDBMS
SQL,
we use
where
the database
is. Yeah.
So here in this case, we do not. Because we are accessing
it
on the Meteor.
Yes, I think, yeah. I haven't tried accessing it directly, but yeah, you could probably check the docs for that, yeah. I think there must be a way for doing that, yeah. Okay, so now we come to updating your record. Let's say if there is some record that is already there and we want to update that, right? So the way you do that is with db.users.update, and then let's say you want to update where the name is Bharani. I mean, you want to update the first record, and then you want to set something, right? Let's say you want to set an age of 21. So here's how you do that. Yeah. So here's how we do that, right? So with Mongo, what happens is that when you update something, so the whole record gets replaced with whatever the new object that you give it, right? So we don't necessarily want to replace it. We want to update. I mean, we want to add something to it, or we want to append something to it. So the way you do that is with calling this $set. And then giving it that object. So instead of replacing, it'll just add it back in. Does that make sense? Yeah. So you also have a few other modifiers that you can use. So there is one that I like that is called $increase, $INC, and then you know you do whatever dot votes if you have like some sort of voting going on, right? So when you click on upvote, it should increment that by one, and when you click on downvote, it should decrement that by one. So for that, you can just do $increase. Let's say you have some update, some increment function. So whenever that increment function is called, what you can do is just do update, give it whatever post you want to update, and then just do $increase votes plus one. If you want to do a downvote, just give it votes $increase votes minus one. Does that make sense? So I mean, this is just a nicety that Mongo provides us. You know, it provides a lot of similar modifiers. You can take a look at the document documentation for that. There is $increase, $set, $push. Let's say you're working with an array, right? Let's say you have a tag list and you want to append another item to that array. So you can do that with $push. Okay. Yeah, and removing is also pretty simple. You can just do $db.collectionName.remove, and then give it whatever object you want to remove from that collection, and it'll remove that for you. So here's when you're using this with Meteor, and let's say you're removing something, so Meteor will automatically update the view also. So we'll see this in action. I think you'll be pretty surprised by that. But yeah, with MongoDB, so to remove, you just do db.collectionName.remove, and then give it whatever you want to remove. I'll just show you an example here. Yeah. So that I just removed the object that said name with that had a name of Bharani, and it got removed. And now when I do a db.find, I just get that one remaining document. Okay. It automatically installs it for you. When you did a curl Meteor install, it automatically did that for you. Okay, so collection. Now we come to collection. So collection is the meat of all that we've talked about right now, right? So collections give you the API that helps. Okay, so collections give you an API to talk to your MongoDB database. So collections, the thing is that collections, you can use your collections both on the client and the server. Because you have database access everywhere, so you'd probably want to use your collections everywhere. So collections let you sort of publish some on the server. What collections does is that it directly talks to your Mongo, then it lets you publish some documents or some sort of data, and then on the client, the collection subscribes to that data. Think of it as some sort of a channel, right? So the server is pushing some data in the server talks to your Mongo and then pushes some data from that server, and then your client actually subscribes to that data and does whatever processing it wants to do with that. Okay, so that is how collections work. Collections is sort of the thing in the between, the thing between your actual database and what the user sees on the website, and then keeps both the things in sync. Yeah, the collections API actually mimic Mongo's API. So whatever we did right now, right? We did collection db.collectionName.insert.remove.update. So collections, the collection API sort of mimics everything. So on the server side, the collections are an interface for talking to Mongo databases. So here you see, like, let's say we've created a collection, then we've created a collection called contacts, right? Let's just forget about how we create collections for now, and let's just think that we have a collection called contacts. It's stored somewhere. It's think of it as some sort of a data structure for publishing and subscribing to records, to JSON documents. So let's say we have a collection called contacts. So the way we add or insert or find and remove stuff from that collection is very simple. So just do contacts.insert. To remove, just do contacts.remove. To find, just do contacts.find. Okay, it is very similar to whatever we did here, right? I mean, to insert a record, we did db.usernames.insert. And then we provided it with an object, right? So similarly with collections also, you can just do contacts.insert and then give it a name of Bharani or whatever you want to do. So your collection sort of mimics the MongoDB API. So is everyone clear with this? Because we'll take a look at this in action, so it should probably be much clearer then. Okay, so inserting records, contacts.insert, inserts a record. finding records, contacts.find. So here the one thing that I want to mention here is that, you know, when you do contacts.find, it gives you a cursor. It doesn't give you that array, it gives you a cursor, but your templates know how to sort of observe on that cursor and, you know, check if anything's been added or anything's been updated or anything's been removed. So it gives you a cursor. So if you want to get that array out of that cursor, you do a dot fetch on this again. That'll give you that actual that'll give you that actual array. We'll take a look at this, you know, when we get to it. So then there's also find one, which just returns one record instead of returning an array. So then updating is also pretty similar. We just talked about it, how you can set something, or you can increase something, or, you know, how you can push something in. Then deleting records is also pretty similar. Contacts.remove will remove it from the collection and from your MongoDB database. Okay. Yeah. Before we come to you know, application structure and all, let's, now that we've talked about collections, let's just integrate, you know, a permanent storage into this. Okay. So the way we do that is inside of this code, at the top, outside of this is client, right? I want my collections to be used on the server and on the client, right? So I want it to be used on both the environments. So I'm not going to add this line of code inside of my is client flag. I'm going to add it outside so that it's loaded everywhere. Here's what I'm going to do. Okay. So here's what I've done. I've created a new variable called contacts with a capital C, just so that, you know, it's clearer. This is a new Meteor collection, and then I've given it something called I've given it a name called contacts as an argument. So what this does is in your database, it actually creates a new collection called contacts. So if you were to change this to something else, so what it'll do is it'll create a collection called contacts too. But I don't want that. I want it to be contact, so I'm just going to leave it at this. So I'm creating a new collection. This is how you create a new collection, right? You do a new, and then you do meteor.collection with contacts, right? You can actually use without providing it any sort of argument, you can actually use, or you can actually provide null here or whatever, and then use this as an only as a only client side collection, which will just act like a session storage on steroids, right? I mean, it won't store anything anywhere, but it'll let you for that user, it'll let you, you know, save data into this and, you know, get data back from it. Okay. The one use case for this would be to show some sort of error notifications. Let's say a user has submitted a form, then you want to say that, you know, form was submitted, or, you know, there was some error. So you don't want to save those notifications anywhere to your database, right? You just want that to show to the seen by the user, right? So for that, you can just use a client-side collection like this. You can actually even create it inside of your is client flag, and then, you know, use it as a local only client-side collection without storing it to your database. Okay. But now we're going to be storing something to our database. So I wanted to have a name of contacts. So here's what I'm going to do. Okay. So now actually we can even start interacting with this. So now I come back to my console. I said, right, I mean, the same collection API is on the client and on the server, right? So we can actually start talking to it with our browser console. So if I do contacts, I get back a meteor.collection, which is what we created right now, right? So to insert something, I would do, like I just showed you, I will do contact.insert. Okay, so now it gave me back this string, which is just the underscore ID. So in Mongo, so there is, you don't have your IDs, you have something called an underscore ID, which is actually an object ID. So this is unique. So Mongo automatically created for us. So this is unique. This is, think of it as your normal ID fields in your regular RDBMS, okay? So if you get back this string, then you know that, you know, it got saved into your database and there was no problem with it. Okay, so how many of you have got to this stage? I mean, how many of you, any errors anywhere? Yeah? Okay.
Because of blocks, code is not right.
a Mongo shell. Just try it once. Try doing it once. Hmm. Can you scroll up? Let's see what the error is. Expert here, he'd probably be able to tell you that.
Excuse me.
Yeah. Security issue. We'll talk about the security aspect right now. Yeah, in just a bit. Yeah. Okay. So now we've just inserted a record, so we can also. Right, so if we do a contacts.find, you'll see that it gives you back a cursor, right? Like I just told you, right? It gives you back a cursor. The way you get the actual array out of that is by calling fetch. Now it gives you back an array with a name of Bharani and an ID that got generated. Okay, so has everyone got this to run? Okay, so now we're actually going to look at how we can put data back into this, store data into our database. Okay. So we have this submit event listener, right? So instead of let's just remove all the session variable that we created. So what we want to return here in this list is what is stored in our actual collection. Okay, so we're going to do collection.find. So here you'll notice that I'm not doing a dot fetch. Yeah, because the template is smart enough to do a dot fetch on itself, on its own, okay? So let's see what this gave us, huh? So I'm just gonna remove everything from here for now. So since I had inserted a record already into my collection, so that record is being shown here. Okay. So the way I told my template to look for that, look for the records in my collection is by doing this, is by returning contacts.find. Okay. Is everyone clear with this? Yeah. Okay. So now inside of my add contact, I actually want to instead of adding it to my session storage, I actually want to add it to my database, right? So the way I do that is very simple. I'm going to get the value of that input field, and then I'm going to do contacts.insert. Is everyone with me till here? So what I've done here is we just talked to this collection with the console, right? So we're doing the exact same thing here, but what we're doing is we're getting the value from that input field, and we are putting it into this into our collection by doing contacts.insert. Is this point clear? Any questions? Okay. So has everyone tried this out? Okay. So if you go back and then you type something here. Now it's showing up. I mean, this was happening earlier also, right? But now the difference is that this is actually stored into your database. The way you check that is by doing a reload. You'll see that the three things still are being shown here. Okay. So now you're actually saving something to your database right now.
When checking the Meteor
Mongo, uh-huh. there all these three things. Yeah, because we're saving to a collection called contacts, right? Okay. Okay, so now we've you know, in this contact app we've looked at adding, right? So let's complete this by doing the CRUD of, you know, let's also do update and delete, just so that, you know, we can, after that we'll talk about, if there's time, we'll talk about how we can organize your app in a better way, or I'll just walk you through some best practice, okay? But is everyone clear till this point? Is everyone able to add something into their form, and, you know, after reloading it should still show up, right? You got this to work? Okay. Okay, so now what I want is that now inside of this list item, right? So there is this list item, right? Okay. So inside of this, I want a button called delete. So what that will do is when I click on that delete button, it should delete that record. That is what we're going to implement now. Yeah. Okay. So CSS is messed up, but that's okay. So here's what we have. So inside of this block where we are iterating over that contacts array, and then, you know, we're rendering that li element. There I have added a button with a class name of delete. So the other classes are just for Bootstrap, you don't need to add that. But I've added a button with a class name of delete. So what I want is when I click on that button, that record should be deleted. So the way I do that has everyone typed out this part? Yeah. So the way we do that is we attach an event listener to it, right? Any questions? Yeah. So actually let's do one thing. So because we're going to be adding a lot of complexity inside of this li element, let's separate it out into a partial. So this is one pattern that you'll see pretty often, right? You'll iterate over an array, and then for each array you'll render a partial. Okay, so let's just see that. I mean, right now we just have one delete button, but, you know, later on maybe you'll have, you know, an edit button, you know, some other complexity inside of that. So I'm just going to do. So here's what I've done. So inside of that each block, I'm rendering a new template called contact item, and then I've created a template called contact item with template name equals contact item, and here I've just pasted in my li. So now let's see if it actually works. Yeah. Okay. So we are getting the same three things again. So nothing's broken. So everything's working. So just that we've moved some code around a bit. Okay, so this is clear, right? So now what we're going to do is we're going to attach events on this contact item template. Okay, so we're going to listen for a click on this delete button, which is inside of this contact item template. So the way we do that is very similar to what we did with submit button, with the submit form. So you do template.contactItem.events. So here's what I've done, right? I've done template.contactItem.events, and then inside of that I'm doing click on dot delete, I mean click on anything with a class name of delete. Then I'm going to attach an event listener. Right now it just alerts something, but this is the part where we're going to do all our deleting stuff. Okay. So now take a look at what I've done. I'm console.logging this. So what happens is that when we're iterating over something, you know, with a hash each, so inside of that loop, so this is set to the currently iterated item. So does that make sense? So let's say we have an array of 5 items. So this, for each time, this is set to that item. Let's say for the first thing it will be set to item number 1, then, you know, it will be set to item number 2. So it's set to the currently iterated item. So now we can come back to the browser, and when we hit delete, you can see, right, the object. You can see that the object with the name of John Doe and this ID got logged. Okay. So now we know. Now we're getting a fair idea, right? How we want to interact with our database. Now that we have this underscore ID, we can easily just remove this underscore ID from our collection. So that's what we're going to do next. Yeah, so that is something that Handlebar automatically does that for you. So inside of this each, let's say you have a regular object, right? A regular object, and you're iterating over that object. You don't need to, let's say that there are two properties called first name and last name. You don't need to do this dot first name and this dot last name there. You can just do first name and last name, because it automatically maps this to that ID, right? So even if you're not using collections or anything, it automatically works that way in Handlebars itself. So you don't need to do this dot first name or this dot any property. You can just call that property. So because Meteor will know that Handlebars will know that it is getting called on this current object. Okay. So now in our JavaScript file, now that we know we have a way to get the ID, we're going to remove that by the ID. So we're going to do contacts dot remove. I think this should work. Let's just see. Yeah. So here's what I've done. It's just one line of code. So it's contacts dot remove this dot underscore ID. That's all we're going to do. So what this code does is that this dot underscore ID gives us the ID of the current element. Then we're going to tell our collection to go find that element and just remove it from our list. And that's what it does. So I can check it right now also, right? I click on this delete, and it's gone, and it's gone permanently. So I probably need to plug in my, just a second. So have you all tried this out? I mean, is this working? So give me just a second. I'll just plug in my adapter. This is inside of your HTML file. So the delete is now working. Is it working for everybody? Yeah. Okay, so we've gotten two things to work. So now what we need to work on is this edit button, right? We need to have some sort of way to edit it. Okay, so for that, what we're going to do, here's what we're going to do. We're going to take a look at the if block helper that we talked about. So here's what I've done. I've added an if statement, which says if is editing. Is editing is a variable that I'll just show you where it comes from. But here's what I'm doing. If is editing, then I'm going to show an input field, and inside of that input field, I'm going to have the name as a value. Okay. So if I want to edit, I can just edit, change the value, and when I hit submit or something, it should update. So if I'm not editing, I'm just showing the name as it was earlier. Okay. So now I need to have some sort of way to figure out which item I'm editing, right? If there are four list items, I want to have some sort of way, like if I've clicked on click the edit button on the second item, I need to show this form on the second item, right? So that is what we're going to do right now. So before that, just let me just add So here's what I've done. You saw that there was this is editing variable here, right? So I'm doing template.contactItem.isEditing, and here I'm returning a session variable called currently editing. I haven't set this anywhere, so I'm going to do that right now. But just you know, keep track of what I'm doing. You know, then you know, when it's complete, I'll just walk you through the whole thing. So if I am not editing, I'm showing the name, and then I'm also showing a button called edit along with it. So what should ideally happen is that when I click on this edit button, so that thing should change into that form. Okay, so that is what we're going to work on now. No, it's hash if. Now it seems to be working. So here's what I've done. Okay, so inside of this this HTML file, I have if is editing. So it just checks if you know this item is currently being edited or not. If it is not being edited, it will just show a name and a button alongside with it, with a class name of edit. So what should happen is that if I click on this edit button, this name should be replaced by a form field. Okay, so here's the code that does that. So I'm listening for an event on the edit button. So I do a click on dot edit. What should be done is that I'm setting a setting a session variable called currently editing, and I'm giving it just 1 minute. what we're doing is that we're setting a session variable of currently editing to this dot underscore id. We just used this dot underscore id to remove that, right? So this is just that unique string. So we're just setting the currently editing session variable to that id. Okay, so then inside of this contact, inside of this is editing, we need to check if we're iterating, or let's say we have five items, we're iterating over five things, and we need to check if item number one has that ID, okay, show a form instead. If item number two has that ID that is there in currently editing, then show a form instead. Okay, that is what we're going to do. Is this part clear? Okay, any questions so far? Okay, so now we come to that is editing, right? So inside is editing, I need to check if it is equal to, okay, so here's what I've done. Inside of that is editing, what I'm doing is I'm checking if the session variable called currently editing is equal to the ID of the currently iterated item. So imagine this, there are five list items, right? I'm iterating over all of them. Let's say I have a session variable called currently editing which is set to four. So I have five list items. So the first I come here, and then this is editing checks the first one. Is the currently editing thing set to one? It's not. So it just shows the name instead. Is it set to two? No, it shows the name and an edit button. Similarly, it checks for three. Then it comes to four. Then when it comes to four, what it sees is that, okay, the currently editing session variable is set to four. So instead of showing the name, I need to show an input field here. So that's what it does, right? It shows an input field here. And then it comes to five, and then, you know, again it fails, so it just shows a name instead. So that is what is happening here. Okay, is that part clear? Okay, so let's just add a cancel button here so that, you know. So I've also added a cancel button here, which does nothing actually. It sort of resets the currently editing variable. So let's say the currently editing, that session variable that was called currently editing, let's say that was set to three, and I hit cancel, the button next to that input field, and I click cancel. So what it does is that it resets it. It just sets it to false so that, you know, it's not true anywhere else. Okay, so that's what I'm doing here. So what this does is that, you know, this edit button sets that currently editing session variable to the current ID, and that cancel button just removes that. Okay, is that part clear? So that's what we're doing here. We can see this in action here. So if I click on edit, I see a form, and then if I click on cancel, that form goes away. Okay, so now what I want is that when I hit enter, or when I submit something, it should update, right? So that's what I want. So here's what we're going to do for that. Just put a form here. Okay, so what I want is when I hit update, or when I hit enter, so when I submit this form, the value should get updated. That's what I want. So for that, what I'm going to do is I'm going to listen for an update event. So this is going to be very similar to what we did when we were inserting records, right? We were getting that value, and then we were setting that inside of by doing contacts.insert. Now the only difference is that we're going to do contacts.update. So the way you do that is submit. So I'm just going to copy paste it here. we got this to work. The way this works is it's pretty similar. I mean, the code is almost exactly the same. So what we're doing is that we're listening for a submit event on that form. So we have a form here, right? So we have this form here. So we're listening for a submit event on this form. And then what we're doing is we're getting the name. I mean, there is a class name or full name on that input element. So we're getting its value by doing t.find full name dot value. And then we're doing contacts.update. Then the ID is this dot underscore ID. We've used this dot underscore ID many times, so it should be pretty clear. It's the ID of the currently iterated item, right? So is everyone clear with that? So we're doing contact. We want to update that item, and we want to set its full name. Set the name to full name. Actually, what you should ideally do here is. What you ideally should do here is you use a $set modifier. $set modifier, and then we're setting the name to the full name that we just got. Okay, is everyone clear with this? And then finally we're setting the currently editing variable to false, so that you know it wipes whatever there is in that currently editing session variable. Okay, is everyone clear with the update? Okay, so now we have the basic CRUD implemented. We have this we can add, delete, and update elements. So I mean, this is pretty much the core of what you can do with Meteor. I mean, you can build like bigger applications on top of this, right? I mean, this is sort of the core that powers every sort of application that there is. So here's something that I built actually. This is pretty similar to what we did today. So here's how it works. So I told you, right? Meteor has this account system that you can use. So the way you use that is pretty simple. So you go to the terminal, and like you added Bootstrap, just do Meteor add accounts base. So these are packages that Meteor already provides you. So this accounts package lets you add a full authentication system, you know, sign up, login, forgot password, all of that with just one line of code. We're just going to take a quick look at that because we're running out of time. We won't be able to customize this, but you can take a look at my code base. There, you know, you'll see some sort of customization there. So but right now we're just going to add a quick login and sign up functionality. The way you do that is you do Meteor add, then you need to add a couple of packages. So one is accounts base, then the other one is accounts password. So this is for sign up with password. And then the third one is accounts UI. So this gives you a nice UI, you know, the login drop down that I just showed you. So this gives you that. So I'm just going to quickly add these three things here. It's sort of the core that powers everything else. Okay.
So if you install this, suppose the account UI, then account base will automatically
get it. I think it will be. Yeah. Okay. Yeah, so this accounts system also lets you add third party authentication. Like there is this package. Let's just do Meteor list. You'll see that there is accounts Twitter, accounts GitHub. This is for the OAuth. I mean, if you've used that before, sign in, login with Facebook or login with GitHub. Can just add that, you know, very easily. Right now, we're just going to take a look at the regular login and sign up. So the way you add that. So now we've added those packages, right? Yeah. So the way you actually use that is, I want to use that in my header. Okay. In the header template, I want that login button and that login dropdown to come here. So the way I use that is with this. And this should be it. Yeah. So there is this one small line of code that you add called login buttons, and then what you get instead is this whole sort of create an account and login and, you know, forgot password and everything else. Okay. So let's just see if this actually works. I'm going to create an account. No, this does not require Bootstrap. This accounts UI does not require. Directives, and I'm not. You can say that. Yeah, directives like the tags that you create, your custom tags that you create. Yeah, yeah, it's almost similar to that. Just that instead of creating your custom tags, you just call this one helper function, and this adds that into your application. So I'm just going to create. I'm logged in, right? I'm logged in with my. It shows the email that I just logged in with. So the way you let's see. I mean, this. If you want to verify that I'm currently logged in, you can just do this from your browser console. It'll give you the details of the currently logged in user. Let's say I log out now. Let's say I sign out, and then I try to do this. It'll give me null. Okay. So let's say I want to sign back in. I can do that very easily. Now I'm signed back in, and I can verify that by doing this. Okay. So this is how you add an entire authentication system with just one line. So now let's say, what you essentially want is that. Before we talk about accounts in detail, let's just talk a bit about application structure, right? You can write your entire application in one file. That's what we've done right now. We've written our entire application in just one .html file and one JS file. That's not the ideal way. You should probably split your application so that, you know, in a production-ready application, you'd probably want to split your application into many, many files so that, you know, it's easier to find and it's easier to work with. So the way you do that is you create a client folder. Inside of that folder, you put all your templates and you put all your JavaScript files. You create a file called server. Inside of that, you put whatever server code that you want to write. And you create a file called public. So this public file will have all your images and your robots.txt and all that sort of stuff. Don't put your CSS files in the public directory. This is very important because CSS or... Yeah.
The client folder, if we create a subdirectory, does it have to be in the...
You can and you should create subdirectories inside of your client folder. So Meteor will automatically read whatever is inside of that.
Each template can be created in a separate.
Yeah. That's how it should be done. So let's say here I have a folder called client, right? This is how a usual Meteor app looks like. So I have a folder called client. Inside of that, there is one file called main.html. I'm calling it main because this will be loaded last. So this is like the file that will call all the other templates inside of this. Okay. Then there is one main.js file, which will again be rendered last. This is where all the subscriptions will go in. Then there is, inside of that client itself, there is one style sheet folder. And here I am putting all my CSS file. I want my CSS file here so that, you know, if there is any change, Meteor automatically picks it up. Or if I'm using something like less or sass, Meteor knows that it needs to be pre-compiled and then converted into sass. So don't put your CSS files into your public directory. You can do that, but it's generally not advisable. Then you have your views folder inside of client. So here, what you should do is you should create a folder for each view. Let's say you have something like you're creating blogging application. You have a post and you have comments. So create a folder called post. Inside of that, have a template called add post, or have an edit post, or, you know, post listing or something like that. And then similarly for comments, create a new folder called comments. And inside of that, comment listing and, you know, add comment and stuff like that. Create one template. This is the key principle here. One template for every one file, right? So if you have one template, put that into a separate file and organize that accordingly. Okay. If that template adds a new post, create a new folder called post, and then create a file called add_post or something like that, and then save it inside of that file. So you should always try to have one template in one file. This is just a best practice. I mean, you're not forced to do it. You can create your entire application in one file, but this is just a general best practice. Then your collections should be outside of your server or your client directory, because you want your collections everywhere, right? You want your collections on the client and on your server, so you want it to be outside of that. Okay, so we just talked about accounts. Is everyone clear with the file structure and stuff? Okay, you can take a look at the app. I'll just share the link with you. You can take a look at the application that I just built. This pretty much has all the application structure that I just talked about. So then there is accounts. We just talked about accounts. We even added it. So there are a couple of things that you can add here. So the accounts base is the base. And then on top of that, if you want a password-based sign-up, you use accounts password. If you want a sign up with Facebook or sign up with GitHub, you can use those packages. Let's just go ahead and add one of those, okay? Meteor, add. So I'm just going to add a GitHub sign in with GitHub button. So this is added. Let's see what this does. Okay. So I'm just going to come here. So my file is automatically reloaded. I'm just going to. Yeah, okay. So now you see, right? So now there is a button called configure GitHub login. I mean, this I'm being shown this button here because I haven't configured my login. So what I need to do is I need to go to GitHub and go to this URL and create a new application and then allow that application to actually, you know, do a login and sign up. Once I do that, I'll do that later. Yeah, once I do that, you can have your users sign in with GitHub, or, you know, with any other service. So this is the workflow for other things also. If you want to do a sign in with Facebook, just do Meteor add accounts Facebook, and then, you know, it'll start working instantly. Okay. So we just took a look at the account. Yeah, security. So now there's this we just talked about it, right? I mean, we even saw it, how we updated stuff from our browser console, how we deleted stuff from our browser console. So there is, I mean, this sort of this misconception that this is not secure and, you know, you shouldn't use it for production applications. So this is just the default, right? I mean, this browser access, this whole browser accessing your entire database, that is just a default that comes in with Meteor. This is because of two packages called auto publish and insecure. So these two packages are like prototyping tools. Think of them as prototyping tools. They give you instant access to database on your client, but once you remove that, right? Once you remove auto publish and once you remove insecure, when you run these two lines of command, so then your client does not have access to your database unless and until you specifically, you know, explicitly give it some sort of access. So what you want to do is, instead of what this auto publish, let's talk about auto publish, right? What this auto publish does is that it takes whatever collections that are there in your database and then just pushes it out to your client, to all subscribe clients. What you want to do instead is that maybe I just want the records for the currently logged in users. Let's say there are 5 users. The user 1 should not be able to see user number 2's records, right? So that should how it should work. So what happens by default is that Meteor pushes everything. Meteor sends user 1, user 2, user 3, every detail that is there, Meteor just sends it out across the server. So what you want is you want to remove that functionality. You do that by doing Meteor remove auto publish. Once you do that, then you want to create a publication. So what publication is that, you know, you tell Meteor what you want to publish. I only want to publish the records for the currently logged in user. So to tell Meteor that, from your server side, you write this one line of code that says meteor.publish, then you give it a publication name. So this contacts that I've written is the name of the publication. Then you give it some sort of function where, you know, inside of this function you can do whatever you want, right? So here I'm just finding all the contacts that have been created by the currently logged in user. So this dot user ID inside of a publish function gives me the user ID of the currently logged in user, okay? So here I'm just finding all the records that have been created by this currently logged in user, and then I'm sending that out via a channel called contacts. Then in my client side code, I'm going to subscribe meteor.subscribe to that contacts channel. I just created a channel, right, that just sends the currently logged in users records. I'm going to subscribe to that channel by doing meteor.subscribe contacts, and that's all. Now user 1 will not be able to see user 2's records, and, you know, similarly, everyone will just have only those access to only those records that they themselves have created or they themselves have access to. So this was about restricting your read access. To restrict your write access, you need to remove this one package called insecure. So what insecure does is that it mimics your database and gives you full access on the client. You know, you can do inserts, you can do updates, you can do deletes on the client itself. You don't want that, so you just remove Meteor, remove insecure, you just remove the insecure package, and then you allow certain functions to be run by the client. So here, I'll just take a look here. So I've created an allow hash, and then I'm providing, you know, what all functionality can be done from the client. This is sort of a permissions check or a permission system for what the client can do with my database. Okay, so if inside of that I have an insert function, so here I'm checking that if a user is not logged in, so this insert gets two arguments. One is the user ID, and then the second one is the document that the user is trying to insert. Then I'm trying to check here is that if the user is not logged in, I don't want to insert anything. You need to be logged in to insert something. So that is what I'm doing here. Then in the update function, I'm checking if there is a current user, if somebody is logged in, and that user and the document that the user is trying to update is his own. I mean, he's the user, he's the owner of the document that he's trying to update. Only then allow this update to happen, otherwise don't allow it to happen. So that's what I'm doing here. And similarly for remove also, I'm doing that if the document that the user is trying to delete is the document that he's created himself, only then allow this delete to happen, otherwise just stop it. So that is what you do in this allow and deny function, in this allow and deny methods. This is sort of a permission system. Only allow this sort of functionality to happen on the client. Deny this sort of functionality on the client. So you do that with this. Is this clear? This only restricts on the client side because your server has complete access to your database, right? That happens in the regular applications also. So this permissions check is for whatever updates are coming in from the client side via the browser console or via the submitting of a form or anything like that. Whatever updates are coming in from the client. For that, you have this sort of permissions check. Yeah, you can do validation on there also. But for that, there is no sort of inbuilt thing. You need to write your own. I mean, you just need to check. You can use all of these validations method. You can probably create that in a separate root directory. In your root directory, you can create a file called lib or something. And then use the same records check because the file is shared, right? You can use the same validation, you know, same functions here in the client here for this allow deny and for your server side validation also. Okay, so there is something called methods. So what methods does is that these methods are functions that are called from the client and are run on the server. So, I mean, let's say you've created a method, right? And that method is, let's say you've created a method and you just, and let's say you've created a method and you want that method to be called from the client, but you want it to be executed on the server only. So let's say you're sending emails, right? You don't want to send emails from your client, right? You want to send your emails from your server. So what you do that is you create a method called send email with this. You do meteor.methods and inside of that you create a function called send email, and then from your client, this goes into your server, and then from your client you do meteor.call, then you give it the name of the function along with whatever arguments you want to pass it. Okay, is this part clear? This is also a way to restrict your client from having full access to your database. Let's say you want to add something. Let's say you don't want your client to be able to add records. So what you can do is that you can create a server side method called add one or add post or add comment. And then from your client, you can do whatever validation check you want inside of that method. And then from your client, you can call that one function called add post or add client. Okay, so your client won't have direct access; it will have that access via the server. Okay.
Doesn't this actually cause the reverse effect? I mean, this is meteor.call is still being called from the client.
Yeah.
So, guy who knows that there is meteor running in the background.
Yeah, and then if he knows that function name. Then if he knows what arguments he need to pass, then he can call that. But you should probably have some sort of validations running on the client, on the server itself. Yeah, so deploying. This is my favorite part actually. So the way you publish, let's say you've created an app right now and you want to share it with everyone else. So usually, you know, you'd probably create a Heroku account and, you know, you'll deploy it there. So with Meteor, what you can do is you can just do Meteor deploy, let's say, I do meteor deploy, and then I give it a URL. So Meteor provides you some sort of hosting. So you can use this for sharing your smaller apps with the world. I mean, if you want to get some instant feedback, you can just do that. You just do deploy, you know, whatever name .meteor.com, and Meteor deploy it for you, and it'll be available there. We can just let it just deploy, and then, you know, we'll test it out. Yeah, so this is deploying. But if you don't want to use Meteor's hosting service, which you probably wouldn't for a production-ready application, you'd probably want to bundle it into a tarball, and then when you unzip this tarball, you'll get a regular Node application that you can run on any Node server, you know, on Heroku or Node.js 2 or wherever that you have Node running, you can deploy this application. Okay, so Meteorite. Yeah, So I'm not going to talk about Meteorite much, but Meteorite is just a way to add. It's a package management and repository version management and a package manager. So you can use which Meteor version you want to run, or you can use Meteorite to add additional packages. So the way you do that is you install Meteorite first. It's on the Meteorite website. You can just go ahead and install it if you want. You can install Meteorite, and then once you have Meteorite installed, you get a command on the command line called MRT. So like you did Meteor add Bootstrap, right? So the way you add Meteorite atmosphere packages is you do MRT add and then whatever package you want from here. Okay. So let's say I want to add pdf.js that is here. Let's just go. There's an atmosphere package called, by the way, you can search for all the atmosphere packages at atmosphere.meteor.com. Okay, just search for whatever you want. I don't think the internet is working, so yeah, it is. So here's what I'm going to add a router here actually. So let's say right now we haven't talked about routing, right? We want some sort of a routing where we want to do /contact/add or /contact/edit. We haven't talked about that because there is no Meteor package for doing any sort of routing. There's a very good atmosphere package called router. The way you add that is by doing MRT add router, and then you get a whole API for adding routes. So I'm not going to talk about how you can add routes, but you can go to my GitHub account. I'll just share the link. You can go there and I have created this whole application with routes. So you can just take a look at that code and it should be pretty easy. But just know that this is how you add packages from the Atmosphere library, okay? Atmosphere repository. Okay, some useful Meteorite packages, router is one that I just talked about. Then you can add SCSS. If you don't want to use less, you want to use SCSS, you can use that. Then there is Bootstrap 3. We've used Bootstrap 2 right now, but if you want to switch to Bootstrap 3, you can just do MRT add Bootstrap 3. That should add for you. Yeah, and then some learning resources. So the documentations are very good. Meteor is very well documented. Go to docs.meteor.com, and that should tell you probably everything you want to know. That's pretty good. And there is this YouTube channel, got some good videos about Meteor. You can take a look at that. And then there is Made with Meteor, actually. I'll just show that to you. Yeah, so the documentation is here. If you can go to madewith.meteor.com. Yeah, this will give you a list of all applications that have been made with Meteor. So a lot of them will also have a source. You can just take a look at the source, click on that source, and just take a look at that source, and you can read through that to learn how they've built it. But yeah, this is a great resource. If you're learning, you can just click on the source and just take a look at how it's implemented. And there are some video tutorials. Go to eventedmind.com and you'll find a lot of video tutorials. So some of the video tutorials are sort of into the Meteor internals, about how it works, and into the internals. So once you're clear with the basics, you can take a look at these videos. They're pretty good. They also talk a lot about Node, so if you're interested in Node, you can also take a look at those videos there. Yeah, so that's all. I guess that's pretty much it. So we've built a CRUD application, we've deployed it. I know I haven't talked in much detail about all the sign up and all, but yeah, you can take a look at the application that I've built. So it's the demo is at contactsmanager-demo.meteor.com. So if you sign in, which I should be able to do. No, it's not built on Meteor, it's on Ruby on Rails. Yeah, I'll just talk about that later. Right now it's about Meteor. So yeah, so here's the application that I've built. So this has edit, delete, and send email. So send email just sends an email. We haven't talked about that, but the way you do that is by adding a package called Meteor add emails. That's it. You just add that, and then you call a function called email.send, and it'll send your email for you.
How does it send the email?
Yeah, you need to give it some sort of, right now it'll just console, it'll just log it to your console, but you need to give it some sort of an email server. Then it'll start working. Yeah, so this is pretty much it here. The code base for this is at, if you can go to my GitHub, it's github.com/Bharani91. So here you'll see three applications actually. So the contacts app is the one that is live that I just showed you. It is based on what we built today. You can just take a look at that. You can just clone that if you want. Then there is contacts app-router. So this is based on the this has also implemented the router. So if you go to /contacts, it'll show you a contact form. If you go to /contacts-edit, it'll edit a contact for you. So you can just take a look at that. And then there is sessions.-contact, which was the first thing that we did, right, with sessions itself and not storing anything into the database. If you want to take a look at that, take a look at that also. So my ID is Bharani91. So if you go to github.com/Bharani91, you will be able to see all the applications. And I guess, yeah, so our application has also been deployed, so we can just go to jsfoocontactsapp.meteor.com and you should be able to view it. Yeah, so if this is real time, yeah. So yeah, I guess you can even use it as a chat application if you want. If you can just type something out, it'll automatically show up here. I guess that's all. So I guess we've talked about the basics. I know there's a lot more that you can do with Meteor. Take a look at there's this application called Telescope. Just do a bit of googling, you'll find this application. It's a very complete production ready application that's been built with Meteor. So you can take a look at that code. That'll give you a lot of insight into how you structure your application and how you write code that is meteoric. But if you have any questions, Stack Overflow is the best place, and then there's an IRC channel for Meteor and then there are many applications on GitHub. Just do a search for Meteor, or you know, you can check out the Made with Meteor site. And if you have any questions, I'm Bharani91 everywhere. Just ping me whenever you want. Yeah. Thanks. Browser compatibility. So it works almost everywhere actually. So what it does is that so this whole polling stuff, I mean whatever is happening, it happens with WebSockets. So if WebSockets via something called sock.js, if WebSocket so the browser compatibility is actually whatever sock.js or whatever that sock.js library supports, it is that, which is IE 5.5 plus, and you know, everywhere it's pretty complete. So wherever WebSockets is available, it uses that. Wherever it is not, it does something like Ajax long polling or something like that to make it work. So so it's pretty complete. I mean, you can use it on even 5.5 IE 5.5 plus, it should work. How performant is it? It might, but I haven't tried that out. I probably need to do a bit more research on that. And what about I have no idea about that. I probably need to do a bit more research into that. Yeah. Okay. So I'll probably need to look into the docs first, because I haven't thought about proxies.